The Dana Show.
In the case of the president, do you get a sense that his regular attendance and adherence to the faith resonates with American Catholics?
I would say that he's very sincere about his faith, but like a number of Catholics, he picks and chooses dimensions of the faith to highlight while ignoring or even contradicting other parts. There is a phrase that we have used in the past, a cafeteria Catholic. You choose that which is attractive and dismiss that which is challenging.
Or, as Thomas Aquinas would say, you allow your conscience to guide you.
Is there something on the menu he's not ordering, in your view,
so to speak? I would say there are things, especially in terms of the life issues, there are things that he chooses to ignore, or he uses the current situation as a political pawn rather than saying, look, my church believes this.
It's also possible to be a practitioner of the faith as a public leader and not require everyone that you lead in your country to be guided by all of the precepts of your faith, right?
And in my coverage of him, it seems that's what he believes.
That's what I would interpret.
Welcome to the program. It's good to be with you. Guys, I was really well behaved yesterday. Oh my gosh, I was just lovey-dovey. I was so good yesterday because they didn't get online and talk about the proclamation and all of this stuff. And, you know, it would be, I'm just saying, and that's what this archbishop was talking about in this. It's some of the most boring audio I've ever heard in my life because I think it's like NPR quality. So it was Kane Rutt, right? This was the archbishop. He called Biden a cafeteria Catholic because of this proclamation that he put out on Resurrection Sunday. First off, welcome to the program. Dana Loesch here with you at the top of this first hour. And good to be with you. So, did you guys read that proclamation? Did you read it, Kane? Yeah. Oh, well, Kane sent it to me first. You sent it to me like the crack of dawn, like the second it came out.
My bad.
Yeah. You sent it to me it was good because you saw it first. This, I had a short piece up at Substack that I had written about this because the proclamation, and I saw some people saying, well, this came out before. This has come out, but I don't care if it's come out before. Every single time it comes out, I'm going to say something. Stop with the whole, well, it came out in 2009, and every time somebody murders somebody, you say it's bad, right? Do you just ignore somebody doing something bad because, well, they did it before? That's such a stupid argument. Shh. So this proclamation about the trans day of visibility on Easter Sunday. On Resurrection Day, this proclamation, and we're going to talk more about it later on in the hour. It stated that Easter Sunday was the trans day of visibility, whatever that means. I don't even know what that means. What does trans day of visibility mean? What is that? We see them.
All the time.
Yeah. I mean, we see it. I see them all the time. It's not like they're hard to miss, okay? The women that on the trans day of visibility are like 8 foot tall, and they have beards and balls. I mean, it's not difficult. Don't even get me started on the dudes, right? So insisting that it falls on a Sunday, the Lord's Day is bad enough, but insisting that it comes on Resurrection Sunday, that's just straight up blasphemous. So it says, blah, 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 virtue. And again, I understand the arguments from the people who have been saying that, well, this is something that I don't care. I don't care every single time it happens. I'm going to call it out. Said that it's the National Trans Day of Visibility. All Americans lift up the lives and voices, blah, 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 blah. There's a couple of things wrong here. First off, I think it's like we were saying, there's too much trans activism, not too little. It's a tiny, little bitty, weensy segment of the population that is struggling with a mental issue, and it's overrepresented by an astronomical margin in entertainment and even and in news and then discussions with news. It's completely overrepresented. But that's on by design. It's all on purpose, why it's overrepresented. It's on purpose because they want this. It's a tactic of mainstreaming it and forcing acceptance instead of people just living their lives. Live your lives. Make your choices. Stop trying to shove it down everybody else's throat. But oh, no, we can't do that because this is America. We can't do that anymore, apparently. So the second thing is we see too little Jesus. We see too little Jesus in entertainment and daily life, everything. Nobody's immune. But that's, you know, that's kind of the point of all Resurrection Sunday. And so to send this thing out, and I was really nice even in the post that I had sent out for Easter Sunday, I was very, very nice. Now it's Monday and I'm not nice anymore. Because I am just so fed up with the saturation, the militant overrepresentation, and this idea that unless you affirm someone else's view of themselves, no matter how fantastical it may be, then you are a bigot, or you are this, or you are that. And that's asinine. There's nothing ever said about the bigotry of people who are trying to, by force or penalty or whatever, demand that other people affirm how they see themselves and refuse to acknowledge any other view, regardless how based in science or reality it may be. If we're going to have a discussion of bigotry, let's talk about the bigotry demonstrated by those people. They had this Easter egg roll. Well, aren't they doing the Easter egg thing? Aren't they doing some kind of roll today or something like that? Or did they do it on Easter Sunday? I don't ever pay attention to anything the Bidens do unless I have to. Yeah. Yeah. And so this whole thing, the Easter egg roll, the rules for that apparently were they couldn't have any Christian symbolism. I don't know if you heard that. That was reported by a couple of different outlets. They couldn't have any Christian symbolism or any like religious symbolism is what they said. But I mean, it's Easter. I mean, it's the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's a Christian holiday. And the New York Post, it was Newsweek, it was a number of things. They said that the religious themed designs were banned from the egg contest is what had been reported. And then you had the American Egg Board that I didn't even know. Did you know there was an American Egg Board?
Yeah.
You did? Yeah. Why? Because, I mean, not why did you know, but why do we have to have it?
No, you're right. And you know how they've been flip-flopping on how bad eggs are? Remember, eggs were bad for a while, then eggs are good, yeah. And then eggs were bad for a little bit, then they're back to good again?
Yeah.
That's them. That's them.
So they were saying, well, no, that's not right. What do you mean that's not right? Religious symbols aren't banned? No, I mean they are. Oh, they are banned? Okay, then what? Oh, but they've been banned from the Easter celebration since 1978. What does that have to do with the fact that they're still banned? And are you so desperate to stand for Joe, let me kiss your butt, Biden, that you're going to, oh, no, they are banned. Okay, they're still banned. What's the point? That's stupid. You're literally talking about, guys, did anybody else rise from the dead? Any other religious figure? No? Okay. It's Christian holiday. Don't sit here and have a Christian holiday about the Messiah coming back to life and then say we're going to ban all symbolism of Christ resurrecting at the Christ resurrection event. You don't get an Easter event without Jesus coming back up from the grave, guys. And it's the single most corroborated thing in entire history. Entire history. You had the disciples that were tortured for it. You had guys, who was it that said this? Is it Chuck Colton who said that the men at Watergate, they couldn't keep it quiet and keep it wrapped up for 3 days? And then the disciples, how many years? And it was immediately corroborated where it happened by the people who were there who witnessed it happening. Never else in any other religion, in any other bit of history, has that ever occurred. So anyway, my point being, you have a celebration of Christ's resurrection, and you're banning religious symbols for this stupid egg contest? I never thought anything could make me hate eggs, Kane, but it did. Congratulations, everybody. And they're like, well, you know, the policy's been in place. And I don't care. Next. So what, egg board? I love that these people are so desperate to defend their progressive messiah. They will do whatever to defend this guy. Well, you know, it's been, I don't care if it's been banned. What does that have to do with the fact that add insult to injury? Now, you also still, for the past several years, have had this and another proclamation. He issues another proclamation for it. You don't see the tone deafness of doing this on Sunday. It's not that it's tone deaf. It's that it was done on purpose. It was a giant finger in the air to all Christians across the United States of America. Christians are hated and still persecuted, and you have Christians killed every single day. This is nothing new. And then everybody else has the audacity to act like Christians are the bullies. I mean, you realize that issuing a proclamation like this and continuing to do it on Easter Sunday, this is the administration that said nothing about the Christian children who were murdered by a trans terrorist in Nashville. You remember how all that went down? It was apparently, you know, the trans terrorist that murdered the children was the victim, according to the press and the left. That person was the victim. They were the true victim in all of this, not the dirty Christians. It was almost like the media reacted as though they deserved it because of their faith. The White House never said anything about that, ever. You're having an event at the White House, but you can't, about, what would this event be without the resurrection of Jesus? It's rhetorical. What? The Easter Bunny isn't real and eggs are stupid. I always thought it was dumb. I never really practiced at my house. Because I'm sorry if anybody, I'm not Big Bird. You shouldn't have me babysitting your children. That's not my job. I'm not welfare Dana, okay? I'm not out here baby. You know, that's a consequence of having it, kids listen to me. It is. I'm doing you a favor. I never did it in my house because I thought it was stupid. I mean, I get it. There was like renewal of spring. But I also didn't go to the event where I had like a chocolate Jesus that you would eat. Have you ever seen those, Kane? They actually mold them. Have you seen those? I swear to you. What would you do? Like if somebody gave your kids like a chocolate, yeah, like a chocolate Jesus to eat or a chocolate cross to eat. It's weird, right? I've never gone that far. But I'm like, I don't do the bunnies. I don't do any of that. I've never done any of that. I've never done, like, the family will do Easter eggs, but I've never been like, yes, there's a magical rabbit that somehow gets eggs and they have goodies. I've never done that.
I have a joke I'll tell you in break.
So it's not, it's a good one.
What do you think? Yeah, it is. What do you think about peeps?
Peeps? Oh, I love to bite the heads off of them. They're great. First thing I did. I did, because it's just the most obvious place to go first, right? And I remember I did it not to be mean. My oldest son was little bitty, and I bit the head off this peep, and he just bawled. Like, oh my God! So like, that was sad. I guess can't do that anymore. So I didn't have peeps in our house for a while. But I did, but do you bite the heads right off them? And then after that, they're no good. That's the only fun part. That's all they're good for. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor-selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
All of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So 60 Minutes has done this, I guess, this in this investigative report where they were looking at Havana Syndrome. And that's that weird sonic weapon injuries that have been taking place in Cuba. And they said that it's linked to a Russian unit, like a special ops, like an intelligence unit. And they were able, there was like apparently some crazy video of a road, like a pursuit, a traffic pursuit. And they found all this stuff in this guy's car, and it had to do, I mean, it's like, it sounds like a Jack Ryan thing, doesn't it? It really does. But they said that it looks like it's a Russian intel unit, according to this joint media investigation. And I'm going to ask Stephen Yates about this coming up. Moscow says, oh, these are groundless, etc. They say they're groundless accusations. We'll see. AT&T says leaked data set impacts about 73 million current and former account holders, according to latest reports. They say that Saturday, a data set released on the dark web a couple of weeks ago impacted about 7.6 million current account holders, 65 million former account holders. And it looks like it's from 2019 or earlier. And they don't even know where, if it originated from AT&T. They don't really know jack squat, that they don't know anything. Apparently, older Americans are drinking a lot because they have to deal with a lot of stupidity. That's my guess. I'm going to wager that. Actually, they say it's because discretionary income and they're bored. I'm not even kidding you. That's really what the two driving factors were. Colleges are facing an enrollment nightmare, and I hope they do so because it's a highway robbery, and that's what happens when Congress consolidates everything at the federal level and drives up the price. We have more to come. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
And Dr. Biden, what's the theme this year? This is something close to your heart.
It is. You know, I've been a teacher for over 30 years, so this is education. So as you can see, there's something for everybody here. So we have science projects. We have phys ed class. You can learn about the solar eclipse that's coming. We have a reading nook. We have dinosaurs. Something for everybody, because education just doesn't happen in the classroom.
Education, kill me now. Welcome back. That was Jill Biden on the White House Easter egg roll. It's education. What does that even mean? That's so stupid. Golly. I mean, I get it. They do this thing, you know, the White House, the Easter egg roll. I think all of this stuff is performative anymore. I think everybody just needs to come out and be like, you know what? We don't care about certain faiths. Certain faiths will bend over backwards to excuse their brutality, you know, like Islamofascism and the new Islamic jurisprudence that says that it's okay to stick grenades in women's vaginas and cut their boobs off and do all of this other stuff in the name of war and a fake occupation because you're the real colonizers, not everybody else. Welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch here with you, bottom of this second hour, and our first hour, rather. And so and I'm going to say it again for the people who are slow on the uptake, right? Because I keep getting, well, Trans Day has been this for this long. I don't care. Do I need to draw these people a picture because they struggle with listening comprehension to the point where they have to have some kind of visual aid to help them process the information that's being distributed from my mouth to their ears? Do they require some sort of visual crutch to assist them? Do they need somebody there to explain it? Do they share the same sort of desiccated intelligence that Joe Biden does that prevents them from fully grasping that? That actually makes it worse. The fact that this year it fell on Easter and they didn't decide to like move it a day, that makes it worse. Thank you for making my point all evermore the stronger. Good grief. That's it though. I mean, look at the way that all of the religions are treated in these United States. Look at the way that the Jewish faith is treated, the Christian faith is treated. But there's some that you can't touch. There's some faiths you can't touch. What gets me is that, take for instance, the battle over what kids, children, minors, are allowed to learn in school and what they're not allowed to learn in school. What they're not allowed to learn in school, it's not even a lesson. It's not even academics. I mean, they shouldn't be presented with materials that are considered of the hustler variety, right? Particularly without their parents' knowledge, which is what a lot of bills like in Florida and elsewhere have sought to remedy, to make sure that parents are still involved and can still make determinations about what is or isn't, something that their kids can have access to. And in Michigan, there's a huge group of parents that got together and they were like, yes, they should not have access to it. And it's amazing because Democrat politicians are like, oh, okay. The difference is that those parents, their faith, they're Muslims. Their faith is Islamic. They're Muslim parents. And they can say this and they're not attacked as bigots and they're not attacked as insert pejorative here. They don't have their characters impugned. There's like certain things that only like one religion can bring up, and then it's considered okay that if they bring it up and then nobody talks about it in the press. Like, go back to, what was it, Prop 8 in California? Prop 8, that was the traditional marriage thing that they were going to vote on, and there was this huge organized effort to try to shame and bully people into not supporting it. And they decided to go after like the Mormons more than anybody else, which was the funniest thing ever, considering it was Black and Latino families in California that were literally driving the support overwhelmingly for that measure. And the Mormons were only like a small percentage of it. They even went after the Scientologists, which, I mean, don't even get me started. They like protested around their thing. They protested at all the Mormon churches. They were targeting like all the Mormons in Utah. I mean, like, they're in Utah, not even California. Because it was easier to target them than it was to target the Black and Latino voters who were driving this because their values are more traditional. They couldn't target them because then they would be violating their own rules. By their own rules, you cannot disagree with a person if they check an identity politics box, because that makes you either sexist, racist, bigoted, etc. See, that identity politic is used as a veneer to deflect any kind of criticism. It is a pass. So you can't criticize them. So the left ran afoul of their own rules. They're like, what are we going to do? Let's go after the Mormons. They're an easy target. Mormons are easy to kick around. They don't chop off anybody's head or blow up anybody's, buildings. They don't do anything like that. You know, they're not out there raping women in Gaza. They don't do anything like that. We're just going to go ahead and target the Mormons. And that's what they did. They weren't going to go after the Black and Latino voters in California that were driving it, because then they'd be racist and bigots, right? And they'd probably lose a very important demo that they needed in order to actually get votes. It's just amazing. I don't know why this, the fact that it fell on that day, they could have moved it by a day. I'm so tired of the visibility. There's too much visibility. There's too much damn visibility. It's oversaturated. It's being shoved down your throats incessantly. Because that's the tactic, that's the purpose. This isn't about tolerance. A lot of people say the word tolerance and they mean total accept, not even acceptance, they mean total adoption. Tolerance, to them, is a word that they use when they mean adoption. It's not enough to live and let live to these people. It's not enough to go about your daily life, do what you gotta do day in and day out, and then just get done, raise your kids, pay your bills. It's not enough. You have to affirm whatever their heads cook up. You have to affirm, and not just affirm, but praise, applaud. When I was growing up, everybody was told, well, what happens behind closed doors is those people's business. Stay out of their bedroom. Now they're dragging you in by your collar, forcing you to watch and applaud. Big difference from then and now. But that was always ever the goal. No, it's about adoption. And if you don't adopt it, then you're penalized. You lose your job. You lose your friends. You're ostracized. They target you in your community. You lose out at sports competitions, scholarships, places on teams, recognition for merit for your born sex. There was I'm going to pull this up. There's a track meet. I just saw this. It happened, I think this was over the weekend. It was like an NCAA thing. And it was a student who was a male student, and running in a women's track event. Anybody who's ever, and I ran track, anybody who's ever participated in track and field knows that women and men are very different with their abilities, right? Very different because they're women and men. Very different thing. The NCAA allows male athletes to participate in women's track events. And I was watching a female athlete that was at University of Idaho and Idaho State University. They lost second and third places because dudes competed against them and they won. This has been going on for years. The NCAA women's track and field champion for 2019 is trans. You have the women's cyclist champion for UCI, two-time trans. The 2019 New Zealand's women's weightlifting champion is trans. The top player in International Women's Volleyball League is trans. Meaning it's a man competing as a woman. These are men who suck as male athletes. They cannot compete at the top level as male athletes, and they treat women's sports like the JV League. They treat women's sports like this is our backup plan. They absolutely do. These are guys who went through puberty as dudes. They competed as dudes even. They competed as dudes. This is recent for the, and this is not the exception. This is 99% the trend. Because they want that scholarship opportunity. They want all this. So they prey on, I'm like, this isn't an ethical dilemma. It's insanity. Insanity. No event there for women. Nothing like that. I mean, you know how different it is with men and women's races? My gosh. I ran track and field in high school. I went to state. I was varsity. Like the moment I became a freshman, I was varsity. I did select throughout the summer, all of that. I was a distance runner. The least I could, the shortest I could do was an 800. And that was hard on me. I can like run forever at the same speed. I can keep a great speed and I literally can run for miles. I have crazy endurance. I just didn't have a lot of the fast twitch muscles that you need for sprinters. I'm not a sprinter. But I would run 4x8 every now and then as like a sub if somebody got hurt. But I ran mile and 2 mile when I was varsity for mile and 2 mile. And I think my best time that I had in mile was like 5:50. I was a 5:40 or 5:49:50. Yeah, I was a crazy miler. Now, but here's the thing. As good as I was as a varsity miler, you know, I went to district, sectional, state, as good as I was, when I ran against dudes, I was JV level. I was JV. I couldn't keep up with the varsity dudes. And I was one of the top athletes in my state. I could not keep up with varsity dudes. It's the reality of it. That's the way we're built. They could keep a pace faster than me, and they could outrun me. They could out-endure. Because that's biology. As good as I was, and as much as I trained, and I was running every day. I was such a jock in school. I did all the sports. I also did classical ballet for 17 years. To the point where I was like fatiguing my muscles. I was so into everything, into all the athletics. But track and cross country were my top. As good as I was, as disciplined as I was with training, and as much as I beat the other chicks, I was JV running as a dude. And that's just the biology of things. I never thought that was unfair or I should be accommodated because I live in reality. And I look at these dudes out there in sports today, track and field. These guys, instead of these track, they'd be JV. Actually, they wouldn't even make their college team, I don't think. They'd be JV. They wouldn't be, they're not first string. They're not good. But they figured out if they run as chicks and they compete with women, oh, hey, then they can go somewhere. I mean, they're outpacing the women in all of these track events. It's crazy. You've seen the videos of them, men playing volleyball against chicks? Have you seen video of men playing soccer against chicks? Basketball? in every sport. It's biology. They don't want to be women. They want to be men playing as women. Don't sit here and say you want to be a part of the sisterhood when you're willing to unfairly use your biological advantage as a way to get ahead of that sisterhood in sports. You're a fraud. That's exactly what all this is. And it's tolerated by NCAA. Why do people, you know, it's not going to stop. Women are going to have to quit en masse. They will. Because this is not a thing where the men can stand up and defend the women. The women are going to have to hit back. Third wave feminists have put women in this very unfortunate position. They sold out the sisterhood. They sold out the very thing that they say they were fighting to protect. Not only did they make it to where you have to have a dual income family, you can't even stay at home with your kids anymore if you want to, but I'll be damned, now you got to worry about competing against women in sports. They think the only true measure of a woman is being out in the field with a man as long as the man's out in the field. That's asinine. Talk about setting women back by centuries. All the work gone. It wasn't good enough to be able to inherit property and vote and have get paid equally. That wasn't good enough. No, they went too far, and now they're reaping what they've sown. What's happening now to women is a reckoning for what third wave did. Those are facts. We have more on the way as we roll towards our second hour. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor-selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
Don't let FOMO get the best of you. Stay in the loop and ahead of the curve by following Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
And I'm coming down to do that Easter egg roll in just a minute. Thank you all so very, very much. Thanks, everybody. And by the way, say hello to oyster bunnies. Come on up, bunnies. Get up here.
I don't want to
see
an oyster bunny. That sounds terrifying. Come on, get in there. Why does the other one have Jim Jones glasses on? One of them has some Jim Jones glasses. You guys know those sunglasses, those big 070 sunglasses? I had an uncle that wore those. The White House Easter egg roll that was Biden at the Days of these United States. Didn't that kick off? I thought it was like on yesterday. It kicked off today. They had a storm delay, so it started. And they had the Easter egg roll, 90 minutes on Monday. Let's see. They had 40,000 people, 10,000 more than last year. And you have to roll hard-boiled eggs across the lawn to a finish line. You can't have any religious decorations on them. And if you note that, the egg board comes out and is like, well, it's been like that since the 70s, because they're so eager to defend against Biden, which is stupid. No one said anything about your precious stalker, you know, target Biden, you absolute fruitcakes. Golly, these people are obsessed. We're noting that it's stupid that you can't put it on there. It's dumb. And then the whole declaration of this Trans Day of Visibility, he issues a proclamation every year. And the fact that this year it fell on Easter makes it even worse. So you can sit here and say that he didn't declare that Resurrection Day was the Trans Day of Proclamation, but he literally did. I don't give a rat's backside how many years prior he did. He did it again. And this time it's on Easter, and it makes it even worse. And yes, it should be called out every single time. But there's a little nuance there that they're trying to seize on that and try to defend it, because Biden has literally said he didn't say it now. He literally has now said that they didn't do it. We're going to play that audio for you coming up at the top of the second hour. They've actually literally have said that. I mean, it's in writing. It's who's in the White House? It's Biden. The White House president sent out a proclamation. He said it. We're going to talk about that and a lot more coming up. Second hour on the way. Stick with us. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
The Dana Show.
I can't imagine going into a foreign country and squatting someone's house. I can't imagine here in the U.S. going to someone else's house and squatting their house. Who is you? Has your votes generationally for the same party, has it improved your situation? Are your taxes lower? Are your streets safer? Are your schools better? What's the answer? You know it. It's no.
The Dana Show.
The criticism over the transgender day of visibility, the White House said that the president wouldn't abuse his faith for political purposes. Does the president think that's what Republicans are doing?
I mean, look, just a couple of things. And really so surprised by the misinformation that's been out there around this. And I want to be very clear. Every year for the past several years, on March 31st, Transgender Day of Visibility is marked. And as we know, for folks who understand the calendar and how it works, Easter falls on different Sundays, right? Every year. And this year it happened to coincide with Transgender Visibility Day. And so that is the simple fact. That is what has happened. That is where we are. And I do want to say a couple of things, because I think it's important here. As you just stated in your questions, what we've been hearing out there, a lot of misinformation done on purpose. And as a Christian who celebrates Easter with family, President Biden stands for bringing people together and upholding the dignity and freedoms of every American.
Sure.
Now, sadly, and it's not surprising, right? It is actually unsurprising that politicians are seeking to divide and weaken our country with cruel, hateful,
and
dishonest
rhetoric. But that's exactly
what
he did, though.
It is dishonest.
That's, first off, and as I've said this before, for the conservatives that are helping the media, the fact that there's been a day since 09 is irrelevant to the fact, and I'm going to say this very slowly, so the drive-bys can understand. The fact that this whole trans visibility thing has existed since 2009 is irrelevant to the absolute fact that the very first presidential proclamation for it took place this year on a Sunday. And not just any Sunday, Resurrection Day, aka Easter. And that was the first presidential proclamation for it. This isn't rocket science. That makes it different. Welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch with you, top of this second hour. And that was KJP just a little bit ago saying that, well, it's, you know, just misinformation. She's trying to say it's misinformation. And they were also, this is what I don't get either. This is from Real Clear Politics' White House reporter, Phil Wegman, who says that Biden was asked about proclaiming Easter Sunday the trans day of visibility. And Biden said, quote, I didn't do that. When asked about Speaker Johnson's claim otherwise, the president replied, quote, he's thoroughly uninformed. But he did literally do that. He literally issued the proclamation. And that's the thing that KJP wasn't being honest about when she was explaining this. She wasn't being honest about it. She was saying that, well, this, it's, you know, it's been around since whatever, and it just happened to fall this year on a Sunday. And, you know, sometimes Easter, you know, Easter falls on different Sundays. Like, she's purposely trying to insult you, and she's acting like you're stupid by trying to explain to you how calendars work. The lady who can't, you know, say that doesn't know the difference between Nord Stream and Nordstrom, that's not a joke, can't say the word emeritus, can't say a whole bunch of other words. Her vocabulary is miles wide, inches deep, can't pronounce a whole bunch of stuff. You know, that chick, she wants to lecture you about how calendars work. But what she's not telling you, as I said, is that this is the first time a presidential proclamation was issued for it. And it was a presidential proclamation that was issued on Easter Sunday. Big difference, don't you think? I mean, of all the years to issue a presidential proclamation for the trans visibility thing, you made it Easter Sunday? And now you're going to try to whine about getting criticism for doing so? Maybe you shouldn't have issued the proclamation. Maybe you should have had your calendar whiz, KJP, check the calendar. Why didn't you do it last year or the year before? Why did you wait and do it when it fell on Easter Sunday? That's the million-dollar question. That's what she does not address to reporters. Because if she did mention that, if she included that very relevant and very important piece of information, then she would be asked, well, why did he do it this Sunday? Easter Sunday. Why didn't he do it last year or the year before that? Why didn't he do it any of those times? Why didn't Barack Obama do it? I mean, it was 2009. Why didn't he do it? Oh, well, she wouldn't have an answer to that, would she? And then she would have to address then the claim that it was done purposefully to antagonize Christians. You know, they've been trying to come out with this narrative, the national Christian nationalist. They did this on purpose to try to inflame that. They want to provoke a certain reaction out of you. They are trying to, with their actions, draw out a specific response from you. They need stuff to bolster this Christian nationalist thing, this narrative that they invented because someone said that our rights, our natural rights, come from God. Now, a quick note on that. That is literally the recognized difference by the founders between natural and civil rights. Civil rights, as we've discussed so often, being created by men in a courtroom for other men. They go through the legal process. It's either done legislatively or it's in a court of law. So they create laws that give that are privileges, not rights. Natural rights fall under the purview of the divine, meaning they cannot be polluted by man. They cannot be perverted by man. They cannot be taken by man or controlled by man. That's why communism feared God. Karl Marx, communism is the opiate of the asses. You know, he was trying to say that religion is the opiate of the masses. Well, communism is the opiate of the asses. And Karl Marx was terrified of Christianity because Christianity challenges tyrants, challenges all of that. If you look throughout biblical history, God even challenges monarchs, trying to force people into being led by themselves and putting God first. Your only monarch should be the Lord. He's challenged people throughout biblical history to this. People demanded a king, though. People love having something to worship. They like to have something on earth to follow and tell them what to do. Not everybody, but a lot throughout history. And so this effort at trying to invent this idea of Christian nationalism, they want to do one of two things. They want to tie in populism, which too much populism weaponized is very dangerous. Populism in small amounts is fine, just like anything in small amounts. Too much and it gets nutty. They're trying to wrap up populism with faith. And by faith, I mean the recognition that natural rights are under the purview of the divine. And that's the cool thing about it, too. You don't have to be a Christian in order for your rights to be protected under that jurisdiction, the heavenly jurisdiction, a natural right by way of being a citizen of this country. You don't have to be a person of that faith or any faith in order to have your rights protected from the pollution of man in such a way. That's the beauty and the gift of this faith and its place in this country. But these people are too goofy to realize that. They want to divide and they want to destroy. Every time, it's always a different vehicle, but it's the same mode, right? It's the same goal. Different means, but same end. They want to destroy faith. Because if they can displace God as first and foremost in the United States, then what can take his place? A tyrant. I mean, that's literally every throughout history. I mean, that's why history is important. It's been like that throughout the ages. That's why communists are terrified of Christianity. Karl Marx was terrified of Christianity. Tyrants are terrified of Christianity because it gives people freedom. And it also reminds these tyrants that you're not number one. So that's what they're doing. This is all about that Christian nationalist narrative. They want to make you ashamed for identifying as a person of faith. They want to make you feel ashamed that your rights fall under the purview of a God that would have Christian nationalists. They're not coming right out and saying it, but believe that's exactly what they're doing. That is the entire purpose of this. They want to pervert it in your mind and misrepresent it to you. They want to cast the seed of doubt in your mind so as to chill speech and also to not affirm that truth, that natural rights do not fall under their purview. They always misrepresent it. Whenever you hear any kind of elected official or anybody really say that, you know, we have natural rights that were granted to us by God, they're like, what do you mean you think God gives you rights? Well, yeah, actually. And? Wait, you prefer men give you rights? Notice how the tyrants always, they always yell and holler about tyranny because they want to be the tyrants. That's what it always is. They get mad at everybody else and they try to cast everybody else as being a tyrant because they want to be the tyrants. And they don't want you to acknowledge that your rights are untouchable. That's ultimately what that means. Your rights are untouchable. They don't want you to acknowledge that. They don't want you to affirm that. So they got to pollute it in your mind. That's what this whole thing was about, to elicit a specific reaction from you. Now, I think the best way to respond to this is that it's Jesus' day of visibility. Jesus basically gets 2 days. That's sad. Don't they get a whole month? The letter people? And then some. And it's not a problem with visibility. We see you. Okay, I was watching the video of this dude who's competing with chicks at a track meet. I don't know if y'all have seen this. Woo! We were talking about it a little bit last hour. Yeah, they had one Olympic track winner hit out at transgender athletes. And it was the trans athlete CeCe Telfer who, as a man, competes against women in hurdles. And of course, guess what? He wins. He won the title. I mean, he beats everybody. He's also like almost twice their height. He's huge. He looks like a dude. You can wear pink. You can put lipstick on. You can grow your hair out. You look like a dude. Neck check. You're a dude. And we are sacrificing women at the altar of this insanity. You can see him, though. You can see CT. There is no problem with visibility. I mean, spot the dude in the image that Juan is showing in the simulcast. Is it A, B, or C? One of these things is not like the other. Yeah? It's not difficult. No, we see you. But we see too little of Jesus in all of it. We have more in store as we roll towards headlines. And coming up, we got some law and order as well. Did you hear more squatter stories? Squatters went into this woman's home, sold her possessions at a yard sale. This is just wild. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor-selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
Man, play stupid games and you're going to win stupid prizes. So an American YouTuber was kidnapped in Haiti because he tried to meet the new gang leader, Barbecue. How did you think that was going to go? That happened. It happened on Friday. The guy is known as your fellow Arab, or simply Arab. He left his Atlanta home, Addison Maloof, traveled to Haiti to interview Barbecue, right? The gang leader of Haiti now. And within 24 hours, the YouTuber, along with a colleague, they were abducted and held for ransom by members of Barbecue's gang. And so they said that they've completely run all of the major areas. They have already abducted 17 Western missionaries since 2021. And they said that they confirmed the kidnapping on social media on Friday, saying, yes, we kept it private for 2 weeks, but now it's out. Yes, he's been kidnapped in Haiti. We're working on getting him out. So that's it. I mean, why would you do that? Why would you go and interview? I can't, man. Let's see. Half of senior staffers in Congress are so fed up they may quit. I hope they get fed all the way up and do quit, because there's too many of them as it is already. A helicopter dropped 10,000 Easter eggs on Indiana kids. This sounds like that could be problematic. Just saying. But it was the Easter egg hunt hosted by the Ross Foundation. And they said that their egg drop, 10,000 Easter eggs on Indy kids. It was a helicopter, dropped the eggs. I'm assuming that it's like they didn't have the kids right there. It was just over a field. They dropped them and then they allowed the kids to go to the field. Yeah, they didn't let the kids come in and then, you know, dropped hard eggs on them. That would have been bad. So a state of emergency was declared in the Niagara region because of the solar eclipse. Now, when these things are declared, they do so because they're expecting so many people to come in and view the eclipse that it's going to overwhelm their roadways. And they said that if there's anything that arises, it would also overwhelm our critical infrastructure. So I get it that they're being proactive in case something goes sideways, but still, it's weird. I mean, we're right in the belt of it, of having the solar. I mean, we're going to be able to see it from where we are, but it lasts for like a few seconds. I mean, good grief. 4 minutes. Just 4 minutes. Like, calm down. It's not the end of the world, unless it is, which I hope it's not. All right, stick with us. More in store. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals, from breakfast to pasta dishes, that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
Looking for the drive-through version of The Dana Show? Check out the best highlights from every show and Dana's Absurd Truth podcast, posted daily from The Dana Show.
Well, apparently the speaker finds trans people abhorrent. And I think he ought to think about that. The fact of the matter is, as you said, March 31st has been a day to lift up transgender people who endure violence and bigotry. Easter, the date changes false every creature. Single day. But this is just one more instance of folks who do not know how to lead us, trying to divide us.
So Raphael Warnock just proves that even the devil can cite scripture right there. That's what that does. Welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch here with you. We are at the bottom of the second hour. You can listen coast to coast. You can stream the radio program, channel 347, DirecTV, YouTube, Facebook, Rumble, X, all the places, Substack, Chapter and Verse. What they fail to mention to you is that this is the first time a presidential proclamation has been issued. It doesn't matter that it's been, you know, that they've had this like day of whatever, because trans people have been invisible this entire time. I don't know if you guys knew this. They were invisible, in fact, until 2009 when a wizard named Barack Obama declared that they are to be visible only on one day of the year. Actually, he didn't declare it. It was just a thing that went up on the White House website. But this is the first time a presidential proclamation by a president was actually issued saying that these trans people are invisible and now they have to be visible one day of the year. And it just happened to coincide with Resurrection Day, which is funny. And I'm somewhat joking. I hate that I have to explain that because our world's so ridiculous. But seriously, what is the visibility day? If they are invisible, why are they not in the military? I'm just envisioning an entire force of invisible transgender people. It's going to be a bunch of dudes in lipstick. And when you send them over there and when they become visible for the one day, that's going to scare the hell out of the enemies. I mean, I'm for that, Kane, right? That sounds like that's, you know, I'm for an advantage. So if they're invisible all the other days, because what else does this stupid stuff mean? It's not, the problem isn't that they're invisible. We see them. They're really hard to miss. But again, like I told you, it's all a part of that Christian nationalist thing. It is. I have a couple of others. Oh, and what he's talking about there too, Raphael Warnock, they were talking about it's abhorrent to actually issue the proclamation on Easter Sunday. That is abhorrent. That's ridiculous. And that was done on purpose. So let's stop. Just stop it. A couple of other things I wanted to touch on with you is we have a bunch of Law and Order stuff as well. We're going to get into some of the got some Republican issues. This is a real tweet. I just saw this. I'm going to talk about Law and Order, so this dovetails right into what we're getting into. This is an actual real tweet. This is Bellevue, Washington. It's their official verified account. I think it's an April Fool's joke. Because it is April Fool's today. I am not allowed to do April Fool's jokes. Isn't there a law about that, Kane, by the way?
It's not a law. But no, yeah.
That people on air, you can't do jokes like that.
No, and you, I think, ruined it, actually, if you remember back in the day. I think this was like 2011.
I didn't ruin it.
Oh, I think you did. What'd and I do? There was I can't remember the specific. If I had more time, I could probably remember the specifics of it. But I do know that you ruined it for everybody after that, because then the boss of that station that we worked for put out the memo. Always that weekend before Easter, or I'm sorry, the weekend before, you know, April Fool's Day.
He put out a proclamation.
Yeah, he put out a proclamation and was specifically made sure that I saw it, because then I would have to tell you.
I don't remember what I did. I'm innocent.
No, you're not. I remember. I don't remember specifically, but give me time. I'll figure it out. Yeah. I'll remember. But
this feels like
you ruined it,
and
now
news.
We can't do any of those April Fool's jokes on the air anymore. We can't do any of that stuff. Because you ruined it like a decade and a half ago.
I did not do anything like
that.
I'm
not kidding.
I don't actually think I did. What?
Selective memory. That's what I'm
saying. I mean,
seeing.
I may have. I'm it sounds like something I would do. I mean, to be fair.
Right.
But I just don't recall it. So it because I don't recall it.
I don't remember specifically, but I remember something. It was something you did on air. We just couldn't do it anymore after that.
Yeah, I don't remember what it
is. It became a law at that point.
Anyway, this looks like the crazy thing is that this, I think this, they didn't say it was, but I think it's an April Fool's joke. But this actually could be real. It could be real. They never actually say it's an April Fool's joke, which is kind of funny. Maybe it's not. The world's so dumb, but they go, as part of our effort to reduce our carbon footprint, we're excited to announce that we're going to replace several of our patrol SUVs with state-of-the-art skateboards. And it says possible delayed response time if you live at the top of the hill. I think it's a joke. Yeah, it's a joke. But seriously, you had to think, didn't you?
For a second.
For a split second, you're like, could be, because things are so dumb. Everything is so stupid that you actually have to take a beat before you figure out whether or not it's real or not. I mean, it's that's the reality. In Texas, there was a judge, this is via El Paso Times, who ordered the release of illegal immigrants that were accused of a border riot. So this magistrate judge on Easter ordered the release of illegal immigrants accused of a border riot. And it's on camera, by the way. There was a stampede that overwhelmed the National Guard troops there at the Rio. And this article is so clunky because they're trying to use certain politically correct words. And it is so ridiculous. These undocumented, oh my gosh, stop. This is an undocumented purchase. I'm just going to steal stuff and be like, it's an undocumented purchase. How dare you? Asking for records. What are you, a Nazi? That works now. I mean, I'm just saying, they said that that's apparently how things go. But this judge said, Humberto Acosta made his ruling on Easter and said that the rioting participation cases will be released on their own recognizance. That's what he said. And it's on video. They tore down the razor wire. They assaulted some of the guard troops. They knocked one of them down. The guard had to work to regain control. And I don't know what one thing that they haven't actually stated, and apparently this isn't evident in the judge's ruling, because there were like actual assaults that had taken place during this riot at the border. And it doesn't actually state whether or not the ruling to just let them go is applicable only to people who participated in the riot and not the assaults in that. It doesn't actually make, but I wouldn't be surprised if it's just a blanket, you know, they're just, you know, across the board, let them go. I wouldn't be surprised. There were hundreds of arrestees. Hey, Kane, if you rioted at Mexico's border with the federales, what would happen?
I don't know. I'd probably be in heaven.
You'd be in a Tijuana jail. That's what happened. Just, wow. Wow, wow, wow. That is, and that judge is just letting them go. That's a new identity politic. If you enter the country illegally now, it is just like being gay or trans or a woman or a person of color, apparently. If you enter illegally. But I think actually, isn't that only applicable to some people who enter illegally, not all?
Don't look at me anymore.
You have to go and get, you know how you can get those paint cards at Home Depot? And it shows you the different hues on it? Yeah. Swatches, the swatches at Home Depot or Lowe's or wherever. And it shows you all the different hues of the paint. You got to get one like that, I think, for skin color, and apply that card to the arm of the people who enter illegally. And if it's like one way on the gradient, you're clear. If it's another way, then no, you don't get to use the identity politic box, because whatever your lighter hue meant that that negated your illegal entrance. See what I mean? So certain things, you have to have like two or more identity politics to not be negated by your skin color. You see, unless you're trans.
It's hard to keep up.
The rules are difficult, man.
It's hard to keep up.
Yeah, it's like really, like whack bat makes more sense. These are very difficult rules, and none of them make sense because they change to fit whatever narrative exists, whatever the narrative is. So with the squatters, this is crazy. New York Post says, in Texas, this is in Texas. Now in Texas, the governor was like, yeah, you can use castle doctrine, et cetera, et cetera. They said squatters turned a Texas woman's home into a drug den and sold her possessions at a yard sale. Terry Boyette was in Florida caring for her sick mother when a friend called to tell her someone squatted her Dallas area home. She had previously hired workers to renovate her house, but after she left, a painter broke in and wrecked the place, leaving crack pipes in her oven and needles in a drawer. It took 6 months for her to get her home back, and she says that all of her belongings have been damaged beyond repair or sold. Her bed's in the backyard. Her dishes are gone. She says all of my stuff has been sold through the yard sale and online. And then apparently the guy who squatted the house was letting people rent it short term and collecting money on that. She was literally leaving. She was caring for her mother, her sick mother in Florida, and her neighbors called. She called police to report the break-in. But she was told that because the squatter had been there for more than 10 days, she would have to evict him. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go in, throw some lead down, and then ask questions after and not apologize for anything. She tried to evict the squatter herself, but it took. I'm not doing that. That is absolute BS. If you want to get killed, there's a great way to do it. Squat in somebody's home. 10 days? Are you kidding me? 10 days. And they had to go through, you have to hire an attorney and go through this whole process. Thousands of dollars just to get an intruder out of your home. In Dallas. And of course, when she finally did get a court date, guess what? The squatter doesn't show up. And then the judge extended the appeal.
No.
Because the judge didn't want the squatter to be homeless over the holidays. I am not joking you. And the homeowner was like, I'm actually homeless over the holidays because this intruder took over my home while I was caring for my sick mother in Florida, and this intruder was only there for 10 days. Yeah. Yep. And it is, oh my gosh, the photos of the devastation are crazy. They say that squatters in Texas can claim adverse possession, but they say it's a very involved process, but clearly it's not, because this was able to happen to this woman very, very easily. So I'm telling you, I'm not, what I'm going to do is I would call the police to report that I had killed an intruder, is how that would work. I have to tell you guys, when we moved, because we kind of had to, our old house that we were in, we didn't put on the market for a while. We were waiting for everything to calm down, and we had this psycho who flew halfway across the country and tried to break in my house because he thought I was there. He had a bunch of pills, and it was crazy. Like, and our neighbors had called the police, and I was at home with my youngest son, and my husband was out with our oldest son. He had a game. And he was out with him. They were like 2 hours away. And God love our police, because they called me. Because I made sure I got to know our police and all that stuff just in case anything happened. Because they were the ones who alerted me to what happened. They called me and they said, we just wanted to make sure that you... But it was funny why they called me. Because they really weren't checking to see if I was okay. They were checking to see if they were going to arrive on scene and there was going to be a dead body there. And it was kind of, in hindsight, it was a little funny because they said, you know, Mrs. Loesch, we just want to check in. We got this report from your neighbors. We just wanted to, you know, find out where you were. And, we know you're lawfully armed and all this stuff. And I'm like, wait, what's going on here? And then, you know, I talked to them later and I had said, yeah, if I was there, this would have been a very different type of phone call. I mean, I've literally trained hours for just that kind of scenario. And, you know, not that I would gleefully take someone's life, but I, you know, when you develop a certain set of skills and you never use them, you know, and then an opportunity presents itself. I'm just saying, if you're the stupid perp that's dumb enough to like try to squat or bust in on my house, you know, some of us may be like, wow, we get to actually use these skills. So I'm just saying, it was a very interesting conversation. And they were very sweet and very cool about it. And we had to, I mean, it was, you know, they acted real quickly. And I cannot imagine, first off, they have to stake out these houses to make sure these people are gone. I mean, you pay attention and make sure that you're not watched when you're going in your home. I mean, we're apparently at that level. My point in sharing all of this, though, is that all of this restorative justice and this idea that we're going to coddle people who aren't the property owners, this is how you're going to get vigilantism. I believe in our republic and I believe in what we've agreed to. But if you're not upholding your end of the bargain as elected officials and you're not allowing law enforcement to do their job, you will get vigilantism. And then you can't complain about it after. And if you try too hard, those people could turn it on you. Just saying.